1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 13. Paul writes, "For this reason we also thank God without ceasing, because when you received the word of God which you heard from us, you welcomed it, not as the word of men, but as it is in truth, the word of God, which also effectively works in you who believe." Now, as we were going through the first 12 verses of 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, I mentioned to you that the Apostle Paul was reestablishing his ministry credentials. He was basically making a defense against false accusations that had been lodged against him by some who were infiltrating the church in bringing bad doctrine and undermining his ministry. I mentioned that false teachers were beginning to influence the church, and some have called Paul into question, and some have begun to transform the message of the gospel that he's been presenting. And that helps us to understand what he's writing in this chapter. Now, today there are some who wonder, why would he even bother to defend his ministry? They'd say, why does this kind of thing actually matter? So what if some don't think that he's a minister? So what if people are questioning his message and saying it's not inspired? Why does that matter? Well, it matters because truth matters. The truth of the gospel matters. Now remember, Jesus told us that by believing his words, he said we would have life. In John 6, verse 63, he said, "It's the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing." He went on to say, "The words that I speak to you are spirit," and he said, "they are life." In John 8, he said at verse 32, "You will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." The truth will set you free from what? Well, in John 8, 34 through 36, he said, "Truly, truly, I tell you, everyone who sins is a slave to sin. And a slave is not a permanent member of the family, but a son belongs to it forever. So he says, if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed." So it's the message of the gospel that sets us free from the bondage of sin. It's a message that reveals how we can be set free from sin and judgment. Now, Jesus' message reveals that God's power is there to save and completely to transform lives. In 1 Corinthians 1:18, the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to those of us who are being saved, he said, it's the power of God. So the gospel is the word of God, and when believed and received, it results in salvation. 2 Timothy 3:15 tells us that it's the Holy Scriptures that are able to make us wise for salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. So it's a message declared that gives people a chance to know the truth that will set them free, and it's the gospel that reveals to us salvation by revealing to us the Savior. Because that is true, it's a message that we're commanded to share with others. In Romans 10:14, "How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher?" In Romans 10:17, he said, "Faith comes by hearing, hearing," he says, "by the word of God." Now, because of its importance, Jesus gave what is referred to as the Great Commission to the church. In Mark 16:15, he said, "Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature." So the important thing is making sure that the message is given clearly and given accurately. In Matthew 28:20, Jesus said, "Teach them to observe all things that I have commanded you." So we're not to add to anything that he said, nor are we to take away anything from what he has said. Now, to go a little further, we need to remember that there's a battle going on for the soul of man. And in many ways, the battle is a battle for your faith. It's more than a physical battle. It centers on the core of the way we think. It's a battle for faith, and because it's a battle that is spiritual, our weapons, the weapons of our warfare, are also to be spiritual. In 2 Corinthians 3, verses 10, verses 3 through 5, "Though we live in the world, we don't wage war as the world does. The weapons we fight with are not weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. It's a spiritual war. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but are mighty through God. So the message of the gospel is literally, literally of eternal importance. And because the gospel is so important, the enemy has constantly warned against it. He has warred against the gospel. Now, early in church history, infiltrators, as I mentioned to you before, began to enter church and church services. And the church needed to establish ways to know that this is an infiltrator. So that's where the letters originated. Letters were written and distributed amongst churches. And Paul wrote many of those letters, and they outlined the beliefs of Christians. Now, eventually, a core of essential doctrine was recognized, and that was established in order to protect that which was true. So that's why the virgin birth, the deity of Christ, salvation by grace, salvation through faith in Jesus alone, his atonement, his physical resurrection, the Trinity, and the inerrancy of Scripture is so important. These were recognized as essentials. They were recognized as the core of our faith. Now, if people did not bring the truth, they were to be exposed and rejected. 2 John verses 9 and 10 says, "Whoever transgresses and does not abide in the doctrine of Christ does not have God. He who abides in the doctrine of Christ has both the Father and the Son." He went on to say, if anyone comes to you and does not bring this doctrine, do not receive him into your house nor greet him. Now, when he says do not receive him into your house, it's not simply saying don't allow him to come into the home you live in. Remember that in the early days, the church met in homes. And so he's saying don't allow a false teacher to come into your church services, infiltrating and bringing in bad doctrine. Don't allow that to take place. Some people say, is that really that important? Galatians 1, 8 and 9, Paul said it like this. He said, even if we or an angel from heaven should preach a gospel other than the one we preach to you, let him be under God's curse. As we have already said, so now I say again, if anybody is preaching to you a gospel other than what you accepted, let them be under God's curse. Another gospel, a different gospel, other than the one you received. It's interesting how the Lord works in my life. He works the same way in all of us in one way or another. But just this last Friday, I was home. I was waiting for someone to come. I thought someone was going to show up at the door. And so there was a knock on the door. And I opened it up, expecting to see somebody else. And there were these two people standing there saying, "Hi, you know, we'd like to talk to you about the kingdom of God." They were Jehovah's Witnesses. And I smiled at them and I said, "Well, hi, how are you?" I said, "Now, I already know what you believe and I don't want to argue with you." I said, "Because when you come to the door, very often you just want to argue." And they said, "Oh, no, we're not here to argue. We want to talk to you about the truth of the gospel because we're bringing the truth. We're messengers of the truth. We have the truth." And so I said, "Okay, let's talk about truth." And I stepped outside. It was a 30-minute conversation. Some of you are familiar with Jehovah's Witnesses. We have members of this church who at one time practiced Jehovah's Witness religion, and also you'll know what I'm saying is accurate. They normally have somebody who is mentoring somebody, so you have somebody who does all the talking. Then you have somebody with them who's doing all the listening. It's very easy to discover which one that is the one who opens the conversation. That's the one that you talk to. But I'm always aware of the one who's being mentored because I want him or her to hear truth that will set them free. So we had a conversation. And so the guy begins to speak to me, and I said, it was a half-hour conversation, but let me share a couple of things. It's about the truth. Because he had just said, we hold the truth and we present the truth. And so I said, I've spoken to many Jehovah's Witnesses over the years. I said, I've been a Christian 53 years. I said, I pastor a church in the local area. Which church do you pastor? I said, Calvary Chapel of the Chino Valley. He says, oh. And I said, yeah. He said, I used to go to Calvary Chapel with Raul Reese. So I wrote Raul, I said, "One of your sheep." I really did. He says, the guy says, "I know Raul." He says, "I went to his house. I was friends with his oldest son, Raul, and his other son, Shane." And I said, "Oh, really?" He goes, "Yeah, I've been to Raul's house." I said, "Well, how did it happen that you became a Jehovah's Witness?" And we began to talk. And as we shared, he said it was because his wife was a Jehovah's Witness, and off he went. We had a long conversation and all that. Let me gel it to a couple of things that I might share with you, a couple of things that are practical. I said to him, you know, and again, I have this young man who's being mentored, young man, maybe 18 or 19. And I began to share with him several things. Again, it was a half hour, but I said, "I'm familiar with Jehovah's Witness and the things that you have to say." I said, "I don't want to be rude. I don't want to come off arrogant, and I don't want to come off pushy. I really don't want to," I said, "but we have severe differences of belief." And as we began to speak, I shared with him a few things, and I'll just give you a couple examples. I said, you know, because he said, "Well, I know that you don't believe in the Trinity, that we don't believe in the Trinity, and you do." He said, "I know that's an issue." He was prepared for that argument, but the Holy Spirit moved me in a different direction. And I said, "Well," I said, "there's several things that we have differences in." I said, "For example," I said, "you don't believe in blood transfusions." I said, "By misinterpreting Scripture as it pertains to eating the blood," I said, "you know," and I said, "again, I don't want to be rude to you. I don't want to come off in an improper way. I certainly don't want to be offensive to you. But you know in your history that in the 40s you were referred to as baby killers, because in the refusing to take the blood, children were dying because of your beliefs." And so he said, "Yeah, I've heard of that." And then the young man says to me, "But you know, there's been one person," and he begins to share about one person who shouldn't have received a transfusion, who survived. I said, "So you have many, many who have died because of your false beliefs, because you know that it was speaking concerning eating the blood that is part of a pagan ceremony. It had nothing to do with blood transfusion. You know that, or you should know that. But in fact, many died, and it was just one survival who didn't take the transfusion. It's many, so many," I said, "that what happened is you were referred to as baby killers, because you allowed so many to die under a false doctrine. You say you're bringing the truth, but the truth that you're giving is not really true at all. It's really a lie. You're deceived." And then we continued in a very nice way to speak a little bit more. And I said, "You obviously know that the New World Translation of your what you call your scriptures is a mistranslation. You know that." I said, "You used to use the King James." I said, "I know that because I used to speak to New World Translation people who would come, and I'd say, 'I don't want to speak from your translation.'" I said, "It's because not a single individual in your translation of the Bible, not a single one, is a scholar of the ancient languages. Not a single one. What you've done is you say, 'Oh, we have given them anonymity to keep them humble.'" I said, "I have a book that can show you the history and the biographical facts of the translators of the King James. Everyone was a scholar. Everyone was devoted to their faith in Christ. But what you did is you hid the names of those who translated, because not a single one is a Greek scholar, not one. So you hid their identities because you created a new Greek tense." Now, he was aware of what I was talking about, because when you read the New World Translation, which I have one in my office, if you read out of it, it says things like this. It's a Greek. They created a Greek tense that doesn't exist. "In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God." John 1:1. In their translation, they say the Word was a God. I said, they have supplied a word that changes the meaning of that scripture. Jesus in John 8:58, "Before Abraham was, I am." Now let me give you what I didn't give him. When he said, "I am," the word in the Greek is ego eimi. Ego and me comes out of Exodus chapter 3, the Septuagint version, where God is identifying himself to Moses, and he says, tell them, I am has sent you. I am. The I am in the Greek Septuagint is ego and me. You have translated from being I am. They have translated from being I am to I have been, creating a different tense. In Colossians, in chapter 1, verses 15 through 17, Jesus is the creator of all things. You can see that yourself if you want. They said he created all other things, making Jesus himself a thing that has been created. In the book of Acts, in chapter 20, and I'll read it to you, verse 28, take heed to yourselves and to all the flock among which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers to shepherd the church of God, which he purchased with his own blood. That's how that is translated. In the New World translation, it says the blood of his own son. No, it says his own blood. And you can go on and on and on. And so I said, you know the New World translation is not accurate. And so he says, well, I said, how is it that you became a Jehovah's Witness? Well, I met a girl and she was Jehovah's Witness and I was brought in. And I said, you know, as we were talking about it, I tried to make it clear. I said, you know, you're in error. And this young man, I said, for example, I said, you say that Jesus Christ returned to planet Earth in 1914. That's in your own publication. 1914. I said, but he didn't, did he? As a matter of fact, you added a couple of other dates past that because he didn't show up in 1914, 1918, 1925, or whatever. I said, he didn't show up now, did he? I said, and the Holy Spirit in your theology is an energy or a force. Where the Holy Spirit is defined and described very definitely in Scripture as a person. I said, so you predicted that Christ, prophesied that Christ had come back in 1914, where the young mentor, the one being the mentoree who was being mentored, the young man said, well, you know, we've had more light since then. I said, you know, Deuteronomy 13, as well as Deuteronomy 18, says a person who is making a false prophet, a person who prophesies something that is inaccurate is a false prophet. I said, so you're part of a false prophet organization. So it was a very cordial conversation. But see, why does that matter? Because he said ultimately, he goes, well, he said, my children, I've raised them and they're good kids because they've been raised in the truth. I said, no, I said, you've got good children because you spent time raising them in a proper way. But they're not good children because of the truth, because you're bringing deception. You're bringing error. You're bringing error. I said, because Mormons can say the same thing and Muslims can say the same thing, that they're giving them what they consider to be truth. I said, but there is such a thing as truth. Now, what I'm telling you right now is not a popular thing to say. Even in churches, churches are mandated, pastors are mandated to tell the church. But we're living in such a time where the truth is being rejected by those who don't think it's loving or kind. They think, oh, you shouldn't say that. You ought to smile when you tell someone they're going to hell. There's something wrong with the way we think today. But pastors have not been called to tickle the ear of congregations. Pastors have been called to tell the truth that sets you free. That's Christianity. And that's why Paul said, if anybody is preaching to you a gospel other than what you accepted, let him be accursed. That's how serious it is. I used to say things in a harsh tone because I feel very strongly about these things. But I've discovered that if I don't tell the truth, people will wallow in the lie. As a father, as a parent, if you knew that somebody was wanting to date your daughter, who had a poor reputation, who had a reputation for using girls and leaving them after abusing them, and you knew this, you knew this guy's got a reputation. You've had people tell you, this guy's a bad guy. He took my daughter out and left her broken. And you know it. And the guy shows up at your house as a father. Do you say, God bless you, baby. Have a good time. Or do you confront the wolf at the door? Amen. Do you say, you know what, baby doll? No. This guy's going to hurt you. And as your father, I've been given a command by God to protect you. And he is not going to have my permission to hurt my daughter. What kind of father would I be if I just said, go on, let's see what happens? Well, as a pastor, I cannot remain silent in the face of error. And my responsibility as a pastor is to tell you the truth. And if people do not like it, they have to take that to the Lord. You see, false teachers were entering into the church. And Paul was outraged over it. And he had said in different places that this has to be dealt with. You see, what happens is to attack this message, very often what they would do is attack the messenger. And because the message and messenger are intertwined, Paul himself would be attacked. And that's what's taking place. You see, if you can undermine the messenger, you undermine his message. In Matthew 9, 10 and 11, Matthew writes, it happened as Jesus sat at the table in the house that, behold, many tax collectors and sinners came and sat down with him and his disciples. And when the Pharisees saw it, they said to his disciples, why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners? They didn't speak to Jesus and say, why are you doing it? They went to the disciples. Why? To undermine the credibility of the master. They didn't go to the master. They went to the disciple. And that's what happens to this day, guys. So if someone brings a message that people don't like, they question that person. Oh, how could you say that? How could you be that way and all? But Paul knew that he and other believers were influencing people's faith in God. And it fueled his desire to safeguard the message as well as his ministry reputation. In 1 Corinthians 10, 32 and 33, he said, give no offense either to the Jews or to the Greeks or to the church of God. Just as I also please all men in all things, not seeking my own profit, but the profit of many, that they may be saved. He said, make sure that your life doesn't conflict with the message. Live a good life and make sure that you're not offending people. You see, a disqualified minister undermines the gospel and the Christian faith in general. It makes the gospel appear to be unable to transform lives. In Thessalonica, false influencers were calling into question the ministry of the Apostle Paul. So in order to safeguard them, he reminded them of his ministry to them. He made it clear that their existence as a church proved his ministry was from God. He had made it clear his ministry should be evaluated in the light of his life, how that he had gone through sufferings and beatings. He remained faithful and bold. His motives were pure towards him, never taking advantage of their faith. He pointed out that he spoke the truth. He exhorted them. He encouraged them with integrity. He said he didn't seek man's attention, didn't seek man's glory. He remained a humble servant. He treated them with loving gentleness and as well as firm direction. He loved them dearly. He was jealous for their spiritual well-being. And that's not just to the church there in Thessalonica. He had similar concern for other churches, including the Corinthians. Because he has said in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 3, he said to them, I'm afraid that just as Eve was deceived by the serpent's cunning, your minds may somehow be led astray from your sincere and pure devotion to Christ. I'm concerned for you, and therefore I'm telling you the truth. He had reminded the Thessalonians of how he endured conflict and opposition, but remained strong. In hard times, he didn't cease to courageously proclaim an unpopular message. And the purpose, as we saw last time, was that they would have a walk that was worthy of the gospel. He had said to them, his teachings, his way of life, were intended to teach them how to live for Christ. He preached a transformed life, and he modeled a transformed life before them. And that's your introduction, verse 13. For this reason, we also thank God without ceasing, because when you received the word of God, which you heard from us, you welcomed it not as the word of men, but as it is in truth, the word of God, which also effectively works in you who believe. Now, last time we were together, I gave to you three elements that you see in the second chapter of 1 Thessalonians. I was speaking to you about the things that make a minister effective. I shared with you about credibility and compassion. I touched on conviction. This particular portion relates to how he brought God's word to them and how he, with conviction, has spoken and their response. Now, Paul had brought the word of God to them. He presented it to them with conviction. He said the gospel came in power in the Spirit, and he said earlier, and much assurance. And this is how they received it. They received it as God's very word. For this reason, he said, we thank God without ceasing. You received it. In light of these things, the things we've endured, we thank God. We continually thank him because our labor was not in vain among you. We praise him. You were open to the word of God. You received the gospel for what it is, the very word of God. Now, not everyone believes that God actually speaks to us through the scripture. Many consider the Bible to be simply just an old book. I remember I was going I was on a trip, and you have to take your keys and wallet out and put it on a conveyor belt and this and that. I had forgotten to take out my pocket Bible. And so they stopped me, and they said, you have something? Oh, yeah. And I took it out, and this young woman says to the guy, oh, he's carrying a book. It's just a book. And I looked at that for some reason. I said, it's not just a book. This is the word of God. And a lot of people look at the Bible as just a book. Gallup, in July of 2022, he's the person who conducts polls and all, said this, a record low 20% of Americans say the Bible, 20% of Americans say the Bible is the literal word of God, down from 24% the last time the question was asked in 2017. Half of what it was at its high points in 1980 and 1984. Meanwhile, a new high of 29% say the Bible is a collection of fables, legends, history, and moral precepts recorded by man. This marks the first time significantly more Americans have viewed the Bible as not divinely inspired than as the literal word of God. We're living in a society that rejects the word of God. Well, in their culture, they did the same. They could have been like Pilate when Jesus was before him and spoke about the truth, and Pilate asked the question, so what is truth? There are so many today who don't believe that the Bible is the word of God, and ministers know this, and sometimes ministers, pastors who are supposed to be teaching will avoid teaching the word of God. Why? They don't want to bore their audience. They don't want to lose their audience. Because there are a lot of people who get bored with a Bible study. Oh, I don't like that. And they forget. They forget that there's power in the word of God. In Hebrews 4:12, the word of God is living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. How do you know what is right or wrong without the word of God making it clear what is right and what is wrong? So they received the word of God. They believed it to be the word of God. They welcomed the message of God. They recognized it was God speaking to them. In verse 13, he said the gospel wasn't the word of men. It's the word of God. They knew it was not of human origin. They knew it was divine revelation. So verse 13, as those who had been saved, the word of God was effectively working in them. Effectively simply means aiding them. The word of God was welcome. It had an effect because they believed and received. And it made an impact on them. They applied the word. They obeyed what God said. His word had an impact, transforming them. And so that's how it works. That's why you get into the word of God. That's why on Sunday mornings I'm giving you a Bible study. I don't need to give you a discourse about how I think culture should change or who I should elect. I need to tell you who the king is, and that's why we have Bible studies. We come to hear Jesus about Jesus and what he wants for us in this world, and it works very effectively in us. He says in verse 14, you brethren became imitators of the churches of God, which are in Judea in Christ Jesus, for you also suffered the same things from your own countrymen, just as they did from the Judeans. By applying God's word, he said, you have become persecuted believers. The Jewish believers were being persecuted. You Gentiles are also being persecuted. Now, you're aware that the Jewish believers are persecuted. You have basically just joined them. And in this way, you're following their example. You didn't shy away from it. You see, persecution sifts the false profession of faith from the genuine conversion. When it gets tough, your faith rises to the occasion. And the one who falls away is one who had no real faith. because your faith is going to be tested. And in Matthew 10:22, Jesus said, you're going to be hated by all for my name's sake, but the one who endures to the end will be saved. You see, it's the endurance of persecution that they demonstrated genuine salvation. Remember this, the history of the Christian faith rests on the fact that its founder was murdered. Not only was Jesus killed, but 10 of the original apostles were also killed. And remember, as we've gone through Scripture, the church grew under persecution, but it becomes weak when it is comfortable. The church today is weak. Why? Because the church is comfortable. And there are preachers who are preaching things like, everybody's going to be healed, and everybody's going to have finances. You're going to be the head, not the tail. And so when persecution arises because of the word, people are surprised. I'm supposed to be dominating here. How is it that they're treading me underfoot and they slip away? Why? Because their faith was not in the Christ. It was in the promises of a false teacher. And that's what's happening today. Jewish believers were persecuted by the Jews. The Thessalonians were being, the believers were being persecuted also by Gentiles. Now, when speaking of the Jews, verse 15, he says this, who killed both the Lord Jesus and their own prophets and persecuted us. And they do not please God and are contrary to all men. They persecuted us. But first, he says in verse 15, killed both the Lord Jesus and their own prophets. The Jews who rejected Jesus campaigned for his crucifixion. They killed him. Their ancestors had also rejected and killed the prophets. Matthew 23, verses 30 and 31 says that you say, if we had lived in the days of our ancestors, we would never have joined them in killing the prophets. So you testify against yourselves that you're descendants of those who murdered the prophets. When Stephen, the first martyr, was speaking in Acts 7:52, the question was asked, was there ever a prophet your ancestors didn't persecute? They've even killed those who predicted the coming of the righteous one, and now you have betrayed and murdered him. He says that they rejected and killed the prophets, but you've also persecuted us. Paul and his ministry team experienced severe persecution. They persecuted, and we saw this in Acts. They persecuted Paul in Iconium, Derbe, Lystra, Philippi, Thessalonica, and Berea. You see that in Acts chapter 14. So this is typical of the rejection. It's typical of those who reject a call to repentance. Nobody likes to hear that they're not perfect. Nobody does. Everybody would like to believe that they're all right and everybody else is wrong. But when you're convicted, that's where you get upset. That's where you reject it. That's where you feel, or you're judging me, or you're being too personal. He says in verse 15, they do not please God and are contrary to all men. They constantly are unpleasing to God. They oppose our preaching. And they reveal they're in opposition to men being saved. And God is not pleased with this. God will judge them. Because he says, verse 16, forbidding us to speak to the Gentiles that they may be saved, so as always to fill up the measure of their sins, wrath has come upon them to the uttermost. Now, Acts 17 records how Paul ministered for 3 weeks in a Thessalonian synagogue. Some had been persuaded. A great number of Greeks and influential people had come to faith in Christ, but the response of the unbelieving Jews caused Paul to have to leave the city. Acts 17, verse 5 says, the Jews who were not persuaded, becoming envious, took some of the evil men from the marketplace and gathering a mob, set all the city in an uproar and attacked the house of Jason and sought to bring them out to the people. Later, Paul successfully ministered in a place called Berea after leaving Thessalonica, but opposition once again occurred. In chapter 17, 13, and 14 of Acts, when the Jews from Thessalonica learned that the word of God was preached by Paul at Berea, they came there also and stirred up the crowds. Then immediately the brethren sent Paul away to go to the sea, but both Silas and Timothy remained there. That had become common in his ministry, and that's why he could remind them of it. Well, what's going on? Verse 16 says, so as always to fill up the measure of their sins. In other words, their sin is leading to their ripeness for judgment. Throughout their history, they had rejected God, and they rejected his prophets. In Jeremiah 32:33, my people have turned their backs on me, and have refused to return. Even though I diligently taught them, they would not receive instruction or obey. That was typical. So wrath has come upon them. God's judgment upon them is certain. The cup is filled to the brim, and they're now awaiting his judgment. And it's as good as already done because they rejected Jesus. Remember in chapter 1, verse 10, it speaks of the wrath that's coming. Later on, the writer of Hebrews in chapter 10, verses 28 through 30 said it like this. He said, anyone who has rejected Moses' law dies without mercy on the testimony of two or three witnesses. How much worse punishment do you suppose will he be thought worthy who has trampled the Son of God underfoot, counted the blood of the covenant by which he was sanctified a common thing, and insulted the Spirit of grace? For we know him who said, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. And again, the Lord will judge his people. The rejection of the proclamation of the gospel continues to this day. Now, verse 17, but we brethren, having been taken away from you for a short time in presence, not in heart, endeavored more eagerly to see your face with great desire. We have been taken away. That was due to the persecution. But he goes back to that mother and father analogy. He said, we've been taken away from you. This is a picture of a parent and their child being forcefully separated. It speaks of the mental anguish and the pain that such a thing would cause. And what has happened is it's provoked his love for them and his desire to see them again. It speaks of his desire for a reunion. I want to return to Thessalonica. And I'm making plans because the agony and the hurt within me is so deep. I have to see you. I want to see you again. Therefore, verse 18, we wanted to come to you, even I, Paul, time and again. But Satan hindered us. For what is our hope or joy or crown of rejoicing? Is it not even you in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ as at his coming? For you are our glory and our joy. A couple of things. Verse 18, we wanted to come to you. Satan opposed us. We were ready to come. We planned to come and we meant to come to see you. I have a great longing in my heart to be with you, but Satan opposed us. Now, the Thessalonians were Gentiles, but they had been taught about the enemy, and the persecution he had endured originated from Satan. Satan did this by using people to hinder him, which is his normal tactic. The opposers later on in Scripture are referred to as servants of Satan. In 2 Corinthians 11, 14 and 15, Paul said, no wonder Satan himself transforms himself into an angel of light. Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers also transform themselves into ministers of righteousness, whose end will be according to their works. Satan opposes. And very often, he'll use somebody to influence you. I can remember there have been times when we've had an invitation where I invite people to stand up, come forward, and I can still remember that there was a disturbance off to the right. And there was a young man and a young woman, and later it came to me because somebody had been seated behind him. And they said that at your invitation, the young lady wanted to get up and give her heart to Christ. But her boyfriend was hindering her, keeping her from doing that, didn't let her get out of the stand up and come out through the row to come forward to get saved. The enemy uses people to get to you. That's one of the reasons we need to be very aware of that and aware of how the enemy will work. And that's what was taking place here. Satan was opposing. And Zechariah 3:1, it reads, he showed me Joshua, the high priest, standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan standing at his right hand to oppose him. Now, in this case, Satan provoked the resistance and rejection of the gospel. He inspired Paul's Jewish opponents to stir up angry opposition. And that's what had happened. He said, I've been opposed to come to see you. But he closes by saying, what is our hope or joy or crown of rejoicing? Is it not even you in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ at his coming. You are our glory and joy. Their salvation was one of the grounds of his hope for future rewards. Their salvation was evidence he had been a faithful servant and that he would be rewarded in heaven. He's saying, you're like the victor's crown awarded in the Greek games. And he rejoiced in their salvation the way an athlete rejoices in their victory. If you watch anything on sports at all, I like to watch on occasion track and field. When I was younger, I used to be able to run. Now I like to watch others do it. And so I've always liked, especially the sprints, the 100 and the 200. And I just was watching the Olympic trials where one of the young ladies had won her particular medal. And the way she just got so excited, and she falls to the track, and she puts her hands and she looks up and points to the Lord, and she's so excited and so exuberant. And she did that because she was winning a medal. And Paul says that's a medal that's going to eventually fade. It doesn't last. But what we have is a crown that lasts forever. That's what we have. And Paul makes it very clear. And that's something that we need to understand. He's rejoicing like a victor. But he didn't rejoice over the garland. Their being in heaven is a high source of happiness to him. And he say, you are greatly loved. You are our pride. You are our joy. You are our crown of rejoicing. You are everything to me, and I love you. You see, for Paul, his joy wasn't his fame or his evangelistic travels or his powerful miracles. It wasn't the authority that he possessed, the honor and respect that others gave to him. He rejoiced because they were entering into the kingdom of God, and that rejoicing will last forever. It doesn't stop. When you're in heaven, you're not going to get bored. When you're in heaven, you're going to be singing praise to the Lord. When you're in heaven, everything is going to be beautiful. There will be no tears, no sadness, no death. Everything is swallowed up by life. And when you're in heaven, you'll be seeing those who went before you. If you had a believing mom, you'll see her. If you have a believing daddy, you'll see her. You'll see the teachers that you love so much. You'll see the children that perhaps you buried who had faith in Christ. You will see your friends. You will see your family. You will see people that you didn't even know, but you've read about. You're going to meet the Apostle Paul, but mostly you'll be at the feet of Christ, worshiping him forever. And that's why you rejoice. That's our crown of rejoicing. And for a minister, the joy of bringing others with him. That's my greatest joy, to know you'll be with us, those of you who are saved, and forever and ever and ever and ever. We will rejoice in the Lord. Psalm 16:11, you make known to me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy, and at your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Forever and ever and ever. And that's what gave him joy. You, he said, are our glory. You are our joy. You are my crown of rejoicing. Because you have been saved. And that's all that matters. It's not the size of the congregation. It's the fact that the people know Jesus Christ that makes the pastor rejoice. And that's why men like me, that's why I in particular, want to be a faithful pastor to you, to tell you the truth, even when people don't want to hear it. Because I stand up and answer to God. I give an answer to him. As long as God allows me to preach in this pulpit, I promise you, I will tell you the truth so that you might be set free.